In the course of her life and its natural monthly cycles, the human female releases some 500 eggs. But in all of history, less than 100 have ever been recovered and observed. The ovum is a mysterious citadel, perhaps the most closely guarded organism in nature. Here it is. From such microscopic beginnings came each of the 77,000 million people born on Earth in vast civilizations that rose and flourished and disappeared. And from an egg came each of the 3 1/3 billions who live on the Earth today. Grim hints of the egg's potential have now appeared. In 35 years, those 3 1/3 billions will be 7. And so, this frail, elusive speck is now, quite suddenly, the overwhelming problem of our time. There is a small corner of the scientific world where men and women are trying to understand the reproductive process, to bring the unique joys of parenthood to the infertile, and to offer far more millions who want and need to limit their fertility new ways of doing so. This is the story of some fascinating problems in research and of things we're learning about the human body that may yet help man escape the indignity and tragedy of his own involuntary procreation. Amidst the noise and bustle of Manhattan's Upper East Side is an oasis of reflection called Rockefeller Institute. Here, along with some of the world's most important projects in biological research, are the laboratories of the Population Council, a nonprofit organization concerned with world population growth. Its medical director, Dr. Sheldon Siegel, supervises the activity of the Council's own laboratories and coordinates a financial grant program that aids investigators throughout the world.
What we know now is a tremendous amount compared to what we knew, say, 50 years ago. The wife of the man who coined the word hormone is still living. She visited us just the other day. Several of the pioneers are still alive and active today. Dr. Gregory Pincus, a biologist who, among his other contributions, includes the discovery that synthetic hormones can be used to suppress ovulation and therefore provide a basis for oral contraception in the human. George Corner is the man who held in his hand for the first time the important hormone progesterone. Without progesterone, there can be no pregnancy, here or anywhere or at any time. Dr. John Rock, a very distinguished clinical investigator who collaborated with Pincus in the development of the oral contraceptive. Professor Bernard Zondek is still a very active practitioner who has a large practice in Jerusalem. He discovered the pregnancy hormone, which even today is used as the basis for all known tests for pregnancy.
There are ways of limiting fertility, and they work. But for people who need and want them most, they often do not work because they call for such a basic thing as running water, or the ability to count, or the discipline that comes with education, or privacy for intimate manipulations, or a kind of preparation some cultures call immodest or immoral. Or 5 or 10 pennies to spare in places where the income is 20 cents a day. Or a willingness to surround the act of love with actions that are unesthetic and distracting. Most contraceptives are mechanical barriers to prevent the meeting of egg and sperm, or chemicals that destroy the sperm cell before it can reach the egg. For the motivated and the well-equipped, These methods are imperfect, but effective. But where understanding or facilities are limited, they can be useless. Recent years have brought two enormous breakthroughs. The contraceptive pill prevents ovulation and makes the female cycle more predictable. It is thoroughly effective in preventing pregnancy and can be used to encourage it as well. The IUD, intrauterine device, is a plastic coil placed in the uterus in a quick and painless procedure in the doctor's office. It can be left in place until pregnancy is desired, and in the meantime makes pregnancy impossible in ways that are not yet fully understood. But the pill is relatively expensive and requires daily motivation, and both new methods call for medical supervision. For the most of the globe's rapidly growing masses, they cannot be the final answer. Dr. Anna Southam of Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center in New York City is a professor of gynecology and obstetrics and a lecturer, advisor, and the visiting physician in fertility and birth control centers that are now appearing throughout the world.
What am I to do for the woman that expels the intrauterine device? The pills make her sick. Her husband won't use a contraceptive. I give her a diaphragm, but I know she won't use it. She'll be back here 6 months from now, pregnant again and desperate. Now, if we were to have an injection that would last for several months, if we were to have a pill that would be effective, taken perhaps on a single day of a cycle, if we were to have a pill that could be taken after intercourse.
The answers Dr. Southam needs are very special. They would call for no sudden increase in human understanding, no sudden change in human values. They are answers we do not have as yet, but the problem is not being entirely neglected. In biology, there is a basic law. All living things come from some form of egg. But where does the egg come from? And how? And when? This is the ovary of a living rat, exposed through surgery. Its surface teems with follicles, tiny capsules, each holding the germ cell of a single egg. What makes one of these follicles suddenly swell and rupture and release its egg is the central mystery of ovulation. At a certain point in the female cycle, a hormone appears in the bloodstream, suddenly and invisibly. A single follicle begins to swell and finally bursts. The egg escapes. Why? What really happens? How can a hormone, a chemical, make a capsule of tissue rupture? What is the mechanism of ovulation? At the Medical School of the University of Washington in Seattle, Richard Blandow, PhD, MD, has sent hormones directly into the ovary and watched eggs emerge from the follicle. But not even the highest magnification of the ovum or its follicle has given him the answer he wants most. How does a hormone make a particular follicle rupture and a particular egg escape?
You may have two follicles located within exactly the same area, sitting side by side, and they may have exactly the same appearance. One will ovulate, the other will not. So something happens within the wall of the follicle that finally leads to ovulation. And to me, this is the crux of the whole problem of ovulation. What is it within the wall of the follicle that eventually will cause that follicle to be ovulated?
This remarkable film, produced by Blandow, of the ovary of a living rat, shows second by second the events that surround the arrival of the hormone, the follicle's rupture, and the egg's escape.
We see that the follicle has grown to a certain size. The small cap, which is being lifted away, and this cap is called the stigma, and that is the site of rupture of the follicle. This then eventually ruptured, and the contents consisting of fluid then poured out onto the surface of the ovary, and eventually the egg with its surrounding cells. And when that happened, ovulation is completed.
What subtle mechanism is at work here? What does the hormone do? Does it somehow create pressure that stretches the follicle wall to the bursting point? Blandau decided to test this long-standing pressure theory. In a year-long series of well-known experiments, he managed to place the tip of a microscopic pressure gauge into a single follicle and waited to see what ups and downs of pressure might occur during the cycle of a female rat. The answer was that there is no significant change in pressure, even at the moment of ovulation itself. The key to the mechanism must lie elsewhere. Blandau's attention has been drawn to something that happens at the point on the follicle wall, where the rupture first begins.
We noticed that almost invariably at the point of the follicle that was opening, a peculiar change occurred within the tissues, and that this change involved primarily a loss of blood flow, so that on the surface of the follicle, a very circumscribed area, a very small area, blood failed to flow in that particular area. And wherever blood fails to flow, tissue dies.
The rupture of the follicle, then, had something to do with the sudden disappearance of blood vessels and a weakening of the tissue through which the egg bursts free. But why should a hormone cause a particular set of blood vessels to vanish? Why at one point on the wall and not another? To find out, Dr. Blandau must delve further into the realm of biochemistry. Long before the search for fertility control, Jeffrey Harris, an Oxford University professor, had been looking for the biological clock, which month by month suddenly releases into the bloodstream the special hormones which somehow signal the human ovary to release an egg. These hormones have been traced to the pituitary, a pea-sized gland at the base of the brain. It was always assumed that the timing device that released them would be found there too. To explore this theory, Harris turned to the rabbit for a very good reason. Rabbits are peculiar. They have no clock. They produce eggs, but not in cycles. The very act of mating makes them ovulate. So does too much handling, or fright, or pain. Things that affect not glands, but the nervous system and the brain. To see if ovulation could be triggered by the brain, Harris placed tiny electrodes deep into the various parts of the rabbit's skull, probing for some kind of control mechanism. His curiosity was soon rewarded.
The result of that experiment was that if the hypothalamus, that's the base of the brain, just above the pituitary gland and connected to the pituitary gland by a stalk, if the hypothalamus is electrically stimulated, then the pituitary gland does indeed discharge hormone, which is carried by the bloodstream to the ovary, and there some 10 hours after stimulation, the eggs are laid. Ovulation does occur.
But how did the signal travel? There are no nerve fibers in the eighth of an inch that separate the brain and the pituitary. But there are tiny tubes for which no use had ever been found. Investigators tried cutting these tubes and found that the ovaries of experimental animals deteriorated. Tubes cannot carry nerve impulses, but they can carry fluids. Some kind of chemical flowing from the brain must be responsible for the timing of ovulation. But what kind of a chemical? To find out, Harris created a living instrument that could allow him to separate the functions of brain and pituitary with a precision no laboratory equipment alone could match. Under anesthesia, he inserted a tiny metal tube through the skull and down into the pituitary. Through the tube, he hoped to bypass the brain and test the effect of various fluids on the gland below. Equipped with his exquisitely responsive little machine, Harris tried infusing extracts which might contain the substance he was looking for. Extracts made from the whole brains of various other animals. 2 days later, a comparison quickly showed that his hunch had been correct. Some chemical, produced in all animal brains, then, may be the timing agent of ovulation. As investigators throughout the world watch with interest, Harris and his colleagues must now work their way through the hundreds of separate compounds found in the brain, looking for a single chemical that can trigger ovulation. The human body contains many special compounds. This is one of them. It is fluid, collected from the fallopian tube of a rabbit. It looks like water, but this is the kind of equipment needed to investigate it. For a tube of fluid is not water. One scientist has been working on a hunch that inside the fallopian tube lie vital answers to the control of reproduction. Luigi Mastroianni is a gynecologist and obstetrician whose immediate concern is infertility and the research that might help him deal with it. Mastroianni's interest in the fallopian tube stems from a time when the tube was looked on simply as a bridge connecting the ovary with the uterus and not as an organ with any special function.
It has since been established that the fallopian tube is much more than a transporting tube, much more than a simple tunnel of love, as it were, for the male seed and the female egg. It is a vital structure which provides an environment, a milieu, for the fertilization process. Well, tubal fluid certainly does have an effect on the relationship between the cells and the outermost layers surrounding the egg and the egg itself. The cells are loosened from the layers immediately around the egg. The cells are loosened in a very special way. If what we are looking at is a sort of conditioning of the egg so that fertilization then becomes possible, it is of extreme importance to find out what there is about tubal fluid which brings about this conditioning. Our approach now is to take each constituent one by one and expose the eggs to the constituents individually so that we can see whether there is one factor or perhaps a combination of factors in tubal fluid which affect the reproductive processes as we see them in the test tube.
In each stage of the cycle, then, new ways of controlling fertility have begun to suggest themselves. But there comes a time when the fertilized egg arrives in the uterus and thrusts its tendrils deep into the wall, enjoining its life processes to those of the mother. It usually joins its destiny as well. For the first moment of implantation is a boundary past which birth control becomes abortion. And so, the last few moments of the egg's independent existence in the uterus are a matter of more than passing interest. If we fail to bar the egg's escape from the ovary or prevent its fertilization in the tube, there may still be a way to impose some kind of barrier to reproduction, acceptable to most cultures. Its last chance, if it exists at all, has to do with something that must take place when the developing ovum first makes contact with its tiny patch of uterine wall in this remote, unviewable area of the human body. Sheldon Siegel combines the administration of the Population Council laboratories with the pursuit of his own personal activity as a biochemist. He and his associates have been studying, among other things, almost every compound thought to stop sperm production in the human male. And they've been working with compounds that might be taken by the female after intercourse to somehow prevent conception. And recently they began an investigation of how the egg implants, which may provide answers to certain other questions as well.
Now we know a lot about what hormones do. I can tell you, for example, that implantation cannot occur unless one of the hormones of the ovary, estrogen, acts on the cells of the uterus, the lining of the uterus, and transforms them, actually physically transforms them. But I can't tell you what the hormone does when it acts on those cells. What we have done has been to take large numbers of rats that have been treated with estrogen, remove their uteri, and extract from these uteri a particular chemical substance, which is called ribonucleic acid, or in the laboratory jargon, RNA. Well, RNA, we know, controls cell growth. Now, I can draw for you what our experiment involved. It really is quite simple. We had a rat like this that had been exposed to the male so that it had fertilized ova in the fallopian tube. In a few days, under normal circumstances, this rat would have implantations in the uterus. However, before these implantations occurred, we removed the ovaries from these rats. Now, this meant that the animal was deprived of estrogen because the estrogen is produced in the ovary. Now, without estrogen, these eggs would never implant. They would just simply disappear, and that would be the end of them. This is a rat uterus. The rat has a two-horned uterus, rather V-shaped, so that you can treat one horn and not the other. We have been able to treat one horn of the uterus with our RNA extract while the other was left untreated. We were quite elated to find, the first time we did an autopsy on one of these treated animals, that we could, in fact, induce implantation with our RNA while the other horn showed no signs of implantation at all. Each of these globular areas represents an implantation site, and in each of these implantation sites is a young rat embryo of perhaps 4 days. It's a very young stage in development. But the important thing is that you see no implantations in the other horn. And this was a demonstration for us that you can, in fact, by using RNA, induce implantation and mimic the action of estrogen. The implications of this are really vast. It gives us an opportunity now to control the action of hormones at a very precise point. And it gives us a reason to believe, at least, that it might be possible to control hormone action at its site of action itself. And this is part of the future.
Which road is the quickest? There is only so much one investigator can do in a lifetime. No one knows where the best chance for the answers to the control of human fertility may lie. But for most investigators, the immediate goal is simply basic knowledge, an understanding for its own sake of each phase of the life process.
We're now basing our attempts to control fertility on one little segment, perhaps an inch of the whole yardstick. But as we broaden our base of information about the reproductive process, then our possibilities for developing means of control will be equally broadened. Someday, it may be possible to have means of controlling fertility, both for those who wish to limit the size of family and those who wish to have children, who cannot have children now. It may be possible to control fertility on the basis of information that we don't yet have. Completely new mechanisms may be invoked in developing applied methods for the control of fertility.
The things of the earth belong to the living, but the living have tampered with the vital balance. And a world population that not so long ago was taking 10 generations to double will do it next in less than 2. It might be that, in time, the resources of Earth and man well used, could bring the elements of a decent life to 7 billion people, or even more. But the evidence would suggest that that time is not now. For even in much of today's world, living means little more than bare survival. And the 7 billions will be upon us in just 35 years. And so, the decision to reproduce still will hold awesome responsibilities for the welfare of children now alive. Communities that now exist. Of a world that is, perhaps already, too much with us. But the choice of whether to conceive or not has been withheld, with irony and tragedy, from those who want and need it most. And to those who see the regulation of fertility as the only real answer for a world in which the rate of human increase has suddenly gone critical, the pace of discovery often seems very slow. 20 years have passed since Harris first probed the secrets of the egg's release, and we have yet to find a way to deal with what he learned. Richard Blandow has spent his life studying the egg, and he has just begun. But in research, time is a basic raw material. There are no shortcuts. For every real advance, 100 other good ideas lead nowhere. And the number of scientists who deal with the mysteries of reproduction is very small. But in several quiet places in the world, things are happening that may, one day, offer both the fertile and the infertile, and everyone, not just a few, some simple, certain means of choosing whether to create what can provide the greatest joy of all, or to make a different choice, and avoid burdens sometimes easier to cherish than sustain. It is hard to think of anyone alive today, or anyone who will ever live, to whom the work of those who seek to offer us that gift of choice will not bring some special benefit.